So I started my journey, I think in 2006, around 2006. I was, I think, I don't know, Manmeet might be aware that I started my journey in film production. I was with Genesis and I was a proper production girl. And something was not seeming right back then. And something inside me was, I was really miserable and I was doing all the things that, you know, everybody does, which is drinking 3 times a week and having the typical Bombay lifestyle. And somewhere it just wasn't resonating with me. So I started looking for answers, and that's when I happened to do my Vipassana course. And simultaneously, I had already started practicing yoga asanas and I wanted to get deeper into it. And I don't know, some switch happened when I went for my first Vipassana course. It was like all the pieces of the puzzle fit together and everything made sense, and I just knew what I had to do. So I just did that, which was following the path, which was basically that I had this strong urge to kind of share what I had experienced or what I had understood. And that's what I've been trying to do for the last, I don't know, 10, 12, 14 years now. And in that journey, I've just basically focused on deepening my own practice for the last how many ever years. And it's only now recently that I've actually started going out and sharing as much as I am. So that's, yes, a little bit about me. You're going to have to ask me a lot of questions to get stuff out of me, okay?
That's
Yeah,
great. We love doing that, so don't worry. So
it's
I'll,
not
yeah.
going to come out.
No, we'll get it, I'm sure. But so coming to the question, you said it's something that you discovered during your Vipassana that now you're being able to share. So what is that that you discovered?
What I discovered was, I mean, it's very difficult to put it in words, but basically what I understood was that the body and the mind and the breath are all very closely connected. And more than understanding, because understanding still remains at the level of intellectual, I had an experience because I went through that course for 10 days, and then immediately, very soon after, in 1 or 2 months, I went for my second course. So I really kind of went deep into it to understand what it was trying to tell me. And my basic takeaway was that it's very difficult to explain. My basic takeaway was that the mind and the body are completely connected. So everything that is happening to me in my body is getting created by my mind. And that's where my journey started of trying to experiment and understand how is the breath connected to the mind? What is happening to the mind? In that, what is happening to the body? So it just kind of took me on a path of self-exploration. And of course, it's not something that is, you know, a switch and then it's all done. That's only the beginning. So since that switch happened, it's been a complete journey of self-exploration, which I think all of us need to kind of embark upon, because again, today we are all going out, you know, everything is looking outside. But this specific thing says, listen, you have to do the work, you have to, you know, do the whatever it is, and it's not always pleasant. And that's the whole thing. It's about creating that awareness that there is no difference, or there should not be any difference between joy and sorrow. You know, that's where we all kind of get lost. That's where we all get pulled down if something that's not pleasant that's constantly happening to us, which happens in city lives, you know, that everything technically externally is aggravating you, but it's not so much external. So the whole journey, it's been a whole journey of finally understanding that we need to find the peace exactly where we are. And actually now being able to help people do that, especially even through this lockdown, sitting in their homes, not being able to even get out, being cooped up, you know, wherever it is, being able to find that peace of mind, not like, oh, you have to go on some retreat or you have to go to the mountains. I've done all that, but now it's come a full circle where I understand exactly what needs to achieve exactly in the moment that we are at.
So, Shatha, you mentioned that you had an experience. Was it an experience that was set in time, in the sense, was it one significant experience that you had that changed or that pushed you on this journey inwards, or have you been having many experiences?
I don't think it's something that just comes. I think it's something that comes from not only this life, but many lives. Okay, it's something that a soul is seeking from many lifetimes, and that's what I feel it is. It's the soul that is seeking from a long time. Even when I was a child, I would ask my mom questions like, okay, God made us, but then who made God? So those kind of questions about who is God, what is God, rites and rituals, I used to accompany my mom to the temple every day when I was little. And then I think I was about 10, 12 years old. And I thought to myself, I started questioning myself when I was very young. Okay, why am I doing? What am I doing? Okay, this is not making sense. Trying to find logical answers, trying to find logic. Because no kind of, okay, you have to do this or this is good and this happens, that happens. That didn't work for me. So I was constantly trying to find answers and looking for those answers, I think one after the other through many experiences led me to what more? You reach that point in life where it's like, okay, now everything is done. You may have the best job or whatever it is that you want to achieve, you have technically achieved. And you're like, okay, now what? I'm still miserable. I'm horrible. I'm like a horrible person inside. I'm cranky. I'm irritable. So I think I reached that point, and it was on my first course. I don't remember which day, it was many years ago now, that I was sitting and meditating, and there was a point that there was nothing. There was no differentiation between, there was no body, there was nothing. I was in the cell, you're in a little small cubicle, which is literally like 3x4. It's a black cell. And I was just sitting in the cell. So there's nothing, there's only darkness. And after a point, there was nothingness. I don't know how to explain that again, but there was nothingness. And that kind of, I understood something that I was actually seeking for. That actually beyond, ultimately, there is nothingness. It goes back to nothingness. So that was a very big thing that kind of opened out a huge gateway in my mind to work towards these kind of possibilities, that we don't even think, we don't question ourselves to these kind of things. So that happened. And then there was another one where, again, a very important realization that happened to me. And again, these are very important because they are experiential, is that again, when you're sitting and meditating, and this will happen to most people who sit, the legs start to go to sleep and they start cramping and it's so uncomfortable that you want to change the cross and you just feel like you're going to collapse. You can't take it anymore. But there was one point where I said, I went beyond. I kept observing that pain that kept coming up. And there was a point that I had reached that I thought my leg might fall off. It was that excruciating. And in the very next moment, it completely disappeared as if it was never there. So again, these are like truths when you experience that, saying that, okay, nothing is permanent. Even the most painful thing is not permanent. Neither is the most pleasurable thing. So then why are we kind of attaching ourselves to this pain as my pain or whatever it is, getting very caught up in that? So those, when I experienced those things, the main thing started coming about now, applying that in your life, in each and every aspect of your life. And that's when the real work started, because that's when I started understanding. And that happened at the very early, I was very young, in my 20s. And that's when my whole approach to yoga changed, because I was like, okay, it's not about the asanas. It's not about many of these things. So thankfully, I never got on that journey at all. I never chased asanas. I never chased many things. I just focused on myself, improvising myself, understanding myself, being on this journey. And just letting the rest, whatever has to happen, just happen. So yeah, it's been a lot of work, because all this sounds very cool and very like, okay, nice. But when it comes to application, it's extremely difficult and impossible. So that's where the struggle has been, and that's where it's still at.
Saiba, since I was gone, I will let you take it from here. I'm glad that the conversation continued. Yeah.
Sure. Okay. No, so how is the Shraddha pre-2006 who didn't do the meditation, who didn't have these experiences, so different from the Shraddha of 2020 where you built this practice? What is the difference and how do you stay with that truth or that knowledge that you've learned now? How do you stay with it?
Firstly, there's a very big difference. The difference would be, I mean, I won't say like in the lifestyle and all that is a given, you know, a typical city lifestyle versus the kind of lifestyle that I live, that I have been living now for the last 10, 15 years. Sorry, I lost your question.
So what I was asking is, how are you different from before your experiences to now?
I think the biggest difference is the awareness, is the gap that I get now when something happens. And initially, like, for example, if I was driving the car, you know, I wouldn't even think. And naturally, if someone crossed or whatever, there would naturally be an abuse or there would be like, you know, what the hell. But now there is a pause that happens before that reaction is to come out. And that reaction doesn't come out. Now it's upon me. Do I want to react like that? And most times it's like, no, I don't want to react. I don't want to even respond to it. So I think that is the biggest difference, is the awareness. Because before 2006, and I would call it, before 2006, I would call it ignorance, you know? And after that, when there's some switch, then there is an awareness. And once you have that awareness, it's very hard to go back. Because then you realize that, oh God, I'm responsible for everything that I do. So I can't blame this one or that situation or that thing, because it's completely my responsibility. So in terms of before 2006 was a very lost, very maybe like also anxious, completely purposeless. So I don't know. It was like, you know, I didn't know anything. It was very purposeless and highly emotional, highly sensitive, not necessarily in the right way, because that also keeps coming from the ego, you know, if you're overly taking things personally and things like that. So that is a very big difference now, because I feel like there is, not all times, but a lot more now, is it's like this. Yes, even if there is an anger, it's I'm immediately aware of it. The necessary changes are made immediately. Everything is very instantaneous. Versus in the past, if something happened, it would be dwelled upon and it would, you know, a lot of things would happen. But now things happen very fast. They happen very momentarily. It's like, okay, this thing in this moment, it's done, it's gone, it's over, it's the next. So trying not to build up too much baggage, which I think was unknowingly happens and was happening before 2006.
And
Shraddha, I felt like...
Go ahead, Man.
I felt like, you know, the way you were talking about how things were, and it just remind me, what year were you talking about when you were in production?
I joined production in 2005.
And you left it by?
I left it around 2007.
Okay, so you're talking about like now, like literally 13 years ago. Yeah. I feel like this is me 18 months ago. So that is how much later similar realization has happened. So firstly, you're lucky to have found that discomfort with your life and being able to look inside and not be happy with the person that you were back then. So, I mean, I think you're blessed that you have saved yourself all these years that many of us, you know, have received a lot later. So,
with a lot of flack from friends initially. I don't know, you know, back in 2006, it was not cool. People thought I was crazy, the lifestyle change, all of that. But I think what I had found and what I had realized was so valuable to me that I really didn't care. And I don't know, like Manmeet has not seen me personally, but you've probably seen me from a distance for all over these years. And the need for external anything, stimuli, validation, it just becomes lesser and lesser and lesser, and after a point it doesn't exist. So you're just doing what you're doing. So yeah, it feels very liberating, and I do feel extremely lucky and blessed. Extremely lucky and blessed.
That's great. I feel a little bit of it, and I can't imagine how amazing that is. But yes, I have. I remember hearing of you that Shraddha went, has left production and has gone here. Now she's in Rishikesh doing this course. Now she's there doing that course. I'm just wondering, acha kya chal kya raha hai? But okay, theek hai, you know. And now it all makes sense, right?
Yeah.
A little bit on the same plane in a way.
I was, even you guys, I was seeking, I was looking for something, but I didn't know what I was looking for. I was looking for the purity because I just knew that I had to go back to the roots. So anything Western, anything fancy, anything, it didn't attract me at all. And I did try, I did all schools, I've tried everything, you know, all the kinds of, all the styles, this, that, everything I've done, been here, been there, packed my bags, went to Kerala, went to Mysore. But then finally, when I got Vipassana and when I got Iyengar Yoga, you know, when I got these two, it just fit, like everything again made sense. And I felt it's very pure, it's very authentic. It's not been, you know, watered down. So again, I got very lucky because I got two paths which were very pure and very old school and very strict. So again, I got to go back to the roots, and that is what I guess has given me this grounding in my practice, is because of these two amazing things that came to me.
In fact, that was going to be my next question to you, was how did you find yoga, and especially Iyengar, you know, this part of Iyengar? Saiba, did you want to ask anything else?
Yeah, no, I think just before we get into Iyengar, I wanted to just understand a lot of what you're saying sounds like a little bit of like controlling of the mind through practice, if I'm not mistaken, right? And to Mano's question, you've gone through lots of different schools, but which ones have been the most powerful and which ones have stayed with you the longest the question.
So for me, it just, you know, when something clicks, it just clicks, you know. So the same way I went, I tried all the schools, but nothing clicked. It wasn't resonating with me. Vipassana clicked the first time itself. I just knew because it was so pure. It's free, you know, and they have centers all over. So the whole system, the whole thing said, okay, this makes sense. It's not some business. And the same thing with Iyengar Yoga, what I realized was that I went and did my Shivananda TTC, which was great. And they have a very beautiful holistic approach to the entire subject. But what I found personally lacking was that in our day and age today, with all of us having so many health issues and our bodies are not ready and they're not fit to be able to go into postures directly. And of course, to get somewhere, to reach the mind, we have to start with the postures. And that is what attracted me to Iyengar Yoga, because there was focus on making sure that you're taking care of your body, you're making sure of the alignment. So there's not just a very haphazard practice, but there's a very conscious, aware practice. That is what, again, it's the awareness, you know, it is the building of sensitivity and awareness within the body and the breaths that attracted me. And of course, I was much younger. I was in my 20s when I got into these things. So I was just doing. But now today, if you ask me, Iyengar Yoga has, like what Guruji has given us, he has shown us how to access the deeper parts of our being through asanas. So we could reach the states of natural pranayama or pratyahara or even dharana or even dhyan, for example, in asanas. And that to me again was very appealing, because at that time I was much younger. So, and again, even for people, because the mind is difficult, if we just tell you to now just keep sitting every day for 10 hours, it's not possible, right? So the whole, both these things started making sense. They started fitting in, saying, okay, this is how I need to keep my mind focused. This is how I need to practice 10 minutes a day. But I also need to take care of my body. And how do I take care of the entire being? So it was like it just fit. And that is what attracted me, the logic, both all the sciences, even the Patanjali Yoga Sutras, what we learn or what I've studied, and the Vipassana, they are both logical, scientific methods. So it's not like, okay, it's not esoteric, it's not, you know, it's very, very logical, it's very scientific, it's very practical, it's very experimental. So these are the main things that have attracted me, because I feel like, especially again in today's day and age, I don't know, gurus, there's a lot of things happening outside. So we don't want to take a chance. Let's just rely inside. You know, let's get the correct tools to be able to go inside correctly, do our own work. Because ultimately, there's nothing that hasn't been said in our books already. There's nothing. It's everything is out there. The whole point is now to not keep looking for someone else outside to tell us, achha, ye karna hai, aise karna hai, wo hoga. But to actually start doing the work. Because that is the real thing. The work, who's going to do the work? And these two systems, 100%, it makes you do the real work, which may not be pleasant at all, which may be discomforting sometimes, agitating, because it's all inside. So it needs to come out. So these two systems gave me that thing that I really could do the work. And that is what attracted me to the system.
So what is this work that you talk of? Like what is it in terms of actionable?
So the work is basically understanding the nature of the mind. Okay. Firstly, understanding that, okay, my mind is like this. Understanding the differentiation between the mind and the ego, the intellect. You know, so again, to be able to differentiate and say, okay, now when something happens, where is that reaction coming from? Is it coming from my mind? Is it like just coming from the old habit pattern, you know, instantly? Is it coming from a space of ego? Am I able to judge the situation? Am I able to respond? So that is the main work, because the main work is not really that vana that you do on the mat. Of course, that's great. It's good fun. You get a good workout, stretch. You know, it helps you to build the awareness to actually carry forward outside the mat. But the work is that. The work is monitoring every moment, every action, every thought, you know, even every thought. So how to do that is to then be in the moment. So that's the work. It's the work is that every moment there has to be work has to be done. It's like, and of course we slip, you know, and we'll slip 1,000 times. But the whole thing is to realize you've slipped and come back and start the work, no matter what happens, even in your practice or whether you lose your temper or whatever it is that happens. So that's the real work. And it's a lot of work, because all our responses, like all our reactions, whatever conditioning, it's very deep conditioning in the mind. It comes from childhood. It comes from past lives. So it's not something that you can just, it's not done like this. You know, it's constant. It's a constant process of, what would you say? Eventually, again, these are all, it sounds very good, but in practice, it's a lot of effort to reach that stage where we are not constantly building karma. And again, that requires a lot of mindfulness, that requires a lot of contemplation on the subject, on understanding what it is. You know, so for example, like when we are doing, like here, being in Goa now, we've been really fortunate to be very close to nature and a lot of animals, and we are able to help these animals in many ways. But like, I would personally, if you ask me, it's not that normally we would say, oh, I am rescuing the animal. You know, I am doing this for the animal. I don't think it's that, because then again, the ego comes in the picture. It's like the animals are rescuing us because they are teaching us compassion. They are teaching. So in every instance in life, it's very easy to slip. It's very easy to go back to the ego space. So to be aware of that constantly is a lot of work. And that's the work that I talk about.
Do you have any tip or technique that you personally use to track your ego and to come back to bring it where you want to when you slip?
Yeah. Firstly, that doesn't happen. It will only happen if you practice it otherwise. You know, like for example, advocate anapana, which is the first step of vipassana. For vipassana, of course, you have to go and attend a 10-day course. You have to learn it properly. You can't learn it like this. But anapana is the first step of vipassana, which is the concentration technique of focusing on the breath. So what happens when you start to concentrate and train your mind to start focusing on the breath? It starts to train your mind to not keep wandering. You know, so 1 second it's here and gone, and God knows where all, it's gone all over the world and come back. That needs to, so when that practice happens normally, only then will you be able to even realize that, okay, I need to now be breath aware. Otherwise, that awareness will also not come. You know what I'm saying? So when you have that practice has to be there, whatever practice, and then that gets carried forward, that saying that, okay, right now I'm really irritated, so let me just immediately focus on my breath instead of my mind going, you know, in circles and getting completely haywire. I just cut that thought process, take my mind to my breath, and it'll settle down 100%. But it will not come unless you do the practice otherwise. You know, that muscle memory or that awareness, it has to be there. It's not going to suddenly come. That is why that practice is very important. So it's the breath awareness. Anytime, that's the one of the most important things that's gotten me through life, through anything in life, is that I just go to my breath and everything just becomes okay, because you just realize again, you know, the whole, everything gets into perspective. And you just come back to center and you're like, okay, everything's okay. And the whole, I guess you just shift, energy shifts.
Okay. So does this mean that you actually sense your breath above your lip? Like you actually sense the movement of the air? Is that what
Yes.
it means?
So what happens is initially when the mind is gross, if you ask somebody to observe their breath, they may not be able to. They'll say, I can't feel my breath. I don't know what's happening, which nostril. Because again, it's a requirement of training of the mind. So once, and that will come with practice. So yes, focusing on this triangular region of your upper lip, just being able to sense, okay, now I'm inhaling from my right nostril, exhaling from my left, or inhaling from my right, exhaling, observing what is happening. So again, the mind, it just doesn't become subtle just like that. So that is why that practice, class, whatever it is that we do, that is why that is important, because on that mat, it teaches us how to do it. And once we get that, then it's easy to apply off. You know, otherwise you, suddenly, yes.
No, sorry. I just wanted to know, do you incorporate this in your, like when you're with your students and maybe you take them into a meditation class before or after yoga? Do you incorporate this as well?
Okay. Yes, I do it in my intensives, because again, it's not so easy. You can't just do 10 minutes and do it randomly. It doesn't work. It has to be, you know, done properly to understand it. And once you've understood it and you've practiced it, then it's okay. So I do it on my intensives. We do a lot of concentration. We do a lot of breath awareness. And I think that's what helps a lot. That helps a student to practice from a space of humility versus ego.
That's very
makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. So, what is? Sorry, go ahead, Mari.
No, go ahead.
So, you know, Shraddha, you've spoken a lot about Patanjali. You've spoken a lot about past lives and how we're carrying forward this, these imprints that are on our subconscious mind, right, in a way. Do you think that all of us have some kind of a life purpose?
Most certainly. Most certainly.
And is it easy to find it? How does one go about finding it when you're so consumed by everything around you and you're living in a city?
You know, so I think that's the beautiful part about the subject, is that it's telling you what the purpose is. It's telling you technically what you have come here for. Now, it depends on you whether you want to go there or not. That's the thing. So, technically, we are, again, now this is all like, I'm talking very, very far-fetched, but it exists. It does. Let's not think of it again because it's coming from the mind. Let's not, because we've been made to believe that, you know, you come, you're supposed to work, you're supposed to achieve X, Y, Z, and then you're supposed to get sick and die, right? That's what we've been made to believe. But if we were not to believe that and we were to think, okay, what are the other possibilities? What was the possibility? What was there in the past, 2,500 years or how many ever years ago, was the fact that as human beings, we came here to achieve samadhi, to get enlightened. That's why we say, you know, that when you're born as a human, actually we are very lucky because we have consciousness. It's unlike the other beings that we have. So when we come here, we have to work towards that. And what is working towards that? That is exactly this, asking the questions. But a lot of us, we don't ask the questions, right? Today, maybe, yes, there's shift happening and we're all being forced to ask the questions. That's why we're asking it. But willingly, no one is asking the questions. Like so many of our saints, when they came, we are not supposed to die, right? They got enlightened or they took samadhi. They choose to leave the body. So that is the level of like operation and how far we've come from that. So I think that all of us have, we are supposed to have that life purpose. And that is why the Ashtanga Yoga has been given to us. Saying, okay, if this is your purpose and you want to reach samadhi, these are the steps. So follow this and reach samadhi. And samadhi again doesn't mean that you have to go and sit on some mountaintop, or it doesn't mean you have to leave anything, you know. So these are, I think, important questions for people to start asking. And again, purpose has nothing to do with passion. You know, it has nothing to do with the kind of work we are doing. Like I might be passionate about animals, sharing. All that is great. That is all life. But the purpose is samadhi. For example, what would samadhi be? What is the... It would just be to be free of this suffering that we are all, you know, everyone is suffering, right? So our aim here is to come and go above the suffering, to understand that. But what happens is we get more caught up in the suffering and we die with that suffering. So that is a sure shot that we're going to come back. That is how the karmic cycle works, right? So if we have to get out of that karmic cycle, then we have to understand what is our purpose. And we have to start trying to free ourselves and not, in fact, create more bondage. Are you all with me?
I'm totally with you. But it sounds like there is then a collective human consciousness of reaching a higher state of being where you can distinguish between the pain and the suffering and say, I'm going to rise above it in a way.
Where actually, ideally, pain, suffering, joy, pleasure, everything becomes the same. Because again, where is the identification coming from that this is pain and this is joy? It's coming from the mind. It's coming from the senses, from your previous past perceptions and conditioning. So we have to eventually go over that as well, like the bad and the good, the right and the wrong. Because that's still, till we are in that, we are still in the duality.
But do you think that when people are on that path, they can then have a sense of detachment from everything around them? And I don't know, in the people that I know who are on that path and the other people who have not reached that place, always think of that person as very detached. And I don't know if that is true or not, but that is at least how it appears on the face of it.
So a lot of people have been telling me this. So, you know, detachment doesn't mean that you don't love or you don't care. It just means that you come from a space of purity. When you come from a space of purity, then there is no expectation of any sort. You just do what you're doing because you're doing it. How do you say that? When you expect, wait, I've lost my, can you ask me the question again?
So I was talking a little bit about detachment, right?
Yes. So, in, you know, when it comes to detachment, then it comes to the thing about Bhagavad Gita, where they say, like, you have to do the action, but you don't have to be thing about the result, right? So that is detachment. But when I'm doing my action, it doesn't mean that I'm not doing my action 100%. That is where I think a lot of people get confused and they start cutting out. It's absolutely not about cutting out. It's not about becoming a cold person. In fact, you become a more compassionate person and you become compassionate to everyone and everything. That is the level of detachment. You know, it's not like you just completely cut off and no. The detachment comes where it's not like, okay, this is mine and that is why I will love it and I will take care of it. And, you know, it's nothing. There is no I-ness or mine. It comes from a much bigger space. So your, that same love, and that is again all idealistic, but that same love has to come for any animal or any human being without saying that, oh, this is my mom, so I'm going to take care of her, but there's someone else and it's going to be different. It's the same. Everything has to be coming from the same space.
And is that where you're headed?
Well, I'm trying. I wouldn't say I'm anywhere close, but yeah.
It's basically the principle of oneness, right? Is what you're talking about. Is that, just for me to understand easily, is that what...
So, you know, to put it in very simple words, is just what I've realized in all these years is that if you make it very simple, you have to be a very good human being. You have to be in the moment. And you just have to be a good human being. That's it. And to be that good human being is the work, you know? Which means you don't have, you know what I'm saying? No negative thoughts, right. Actions, everything. Just that. You just have to be that. And that's right. It. Everything else falls into place. But it's not easy because we all have that jealousy and we all have all these emotions within us. And those are the emotions that when they surface, you know, how do we handle that? How do we make it stronger? Do we weaken it? Do we let it completely go?
So, Shraddha, why do you think these emotions are within us? What is the lesson there for having these negative reactions and having these negative emotions?
So that's, again, all these emotions are there because that's the mind. That's the nature of the mind, okay? These are the things how, again, if we get into the sutras and it's all very scientifically given of what are the characteristics, what are the vrittis, what are the modifications, what are the states of the mind. So everything is actually written down and it's amazing. Imagine 2,500 years ago, it's written down and it's 100% valid or even more valid even today because you're like, oh yeah, these are the five issues. So these are all deep-rooted because this is the nature of the mind. And that is what we need to understand that, okay, this is the nature of the mind. It's not me. So then who am I if I'm not the mind, if I'm not associating with that mind? So then that disassociation starts. You know, then when something happens, you don't take it. Everything is not like, oh, mine and I'm gone and I'm... It's not... It doesn't go inside. It just comes and it falls off like the arrow. It doesn't penetrate deeply. So it's like a shield of sorts.
Amazing. Shraddha, are you happy with where you are right now in life? Are you content?
Yes, I'm very happy actually. And I'm learning every day. I wouldn't say when I say happy and content, I'm not going to say each day is like, you know, I'm on cloud nine. No, there's always lots of... There's a lot of learnings, you know, constantly, and they keep getting harder and harder. The more you walk, the more the challenges, the harder the path gets. So what makes me really content and happy is that no matter what happens, that I know that I have somewhere to go to. And that's all that I require. And that somewhere is inside.
Okay. Right. You've found that path inside.
I found that. Yes. I found that space, that spot inside. I don't need to go outside.
Right. Why do you say the path gets harder and more challenging? I was hoping it gets easier.
No. It doesn't get easier because as you go along, the more deep-rooted things will start coming out, you know? So the things which are like completely hidden within. So for that real work to happen, that and the whatever's hidden within is like deep down is the most unpleasant, no? Which we've kind of just shut down, and the trauma, the pain, maybe so much pain that we've just shut down some things in life. So those things have to come. So if that's come and it's gone, then it's good. Then you're light. But till that's not come up and you've not let it surface, you've not observed it, you've not, you know, responded to it, then it's going to be a thing. It's going to be, because again, it's not about the asanas. No, it's not about that handstand, or of course that's intensive practice. But anyone who's doing the mind work will tell you that it's not easy, you know, because every time you do something, we forget. And then again, we have to learn that lesson. And again, we have to learn that lesson. And a lot of us, we don't even think about it like that. We don't look at it in a macro. We don't try to understand the dots. We don't try to learn. You know, we have just forgotten. So then we keep making the same mistakes and we are still in the same loop. And then we say, why are we in the same loop? Because we are not doing anything different. So obviously you're going to be in the same loop. So it's about, I guess, realizing and just making sure that you're out of that loop.
So, Shraddha, do you still study? Are you still teaching yourself? Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. That is the most important thing. Without that, it's impossible.
So what do you study? What are you studying and how does your day go?
Right now I'm studying the sutras, the Patanjali Yoga Sutras. My study is more like my internal practice. It's a lot of anapana, a lot of vipassana, a lot of... Basically, once I get on the mat, it's, I don't know, sometimes 3-4 hours where it goes. And every time is different. And now the practice has started changing to different aspects of yoga as well, which is not only like, which is also more towards karma yoga, you know. So now for me, and again, living in a city, we don't have that kind of access, you know, we don't see animals, we are not so connected to nature, so we don't realize how much work needs to be done. So a lot of now my understanding of yoga is taking care of all the animals here. So that is yoga, and the definition of yoga keeps changing. You know, sometimes being a good daughter is yoga, sometimes taking care of animals is yoga. So it keeps changing.
Yeah. So do you try to follow all the Ashtanga, like the 8 principles, or is it?
Yes, I do, but again, you know, we like, it's like now the first, the Yama, the first one, Ahimsa, which is non-violence. Now, as much as I may say, yes, I don't want to eat meat and I don't want to do, but yes, sometimes that thought comes, some violent thought might come, maybe not even towards someone else, but maybe towards the self, you know? So it's a constant process. I cannot say that I have arrived. It's impossible for me to say that, because just with Yama Niyamas, just with those 10, if I keep checking myself, yes, of course I'm failing. You know, it may be in the smallest of things, but you keep failing, but you realize and you keep coming back. So there's a burning, like there's a fire inside to be on the path. And I do as much as I can to be on it. And sometimes you slip. And that's also fine, as long as you get up and you continue. So that's the main thing, I think, you know. You're going to slip 5 million times. Just keep getting up and keep going. That's the only thing.
What is your favorite yogic piece of wisdom or something that you live by or you, you know, that has helped you?
Yogic wisdom...
Or, okay, any other piece of wisdom?
Piece like a one line, you're saying?
It could be a mantra. Like, do you keep a mantra with you on a regular basis or something that, you know, you think of when you meditate or something you like, a mantra you like to chant? or you have it changing from time to time?
No, I don't have it changing. I usually stick with my Om or my Om Namah Shivaya. But the month, like something that has stuck with me is this quote actually by, I think, Confucius. It says, infinite patience yields immediate results.
Could you explain that a bit?
You have to contemplate on it.
Okay. I wanted to show you what book I'm reading.
Oh, nice.
I don't know.
Nice. Yeah. Yes. Nice. How is it? Are you liking it?
It's very hard to understand. Intense. I've only read like this much. Oh God. Yeah. I'm constantly Googling on the side. What is Klesha? Like, Klesha. It's so hard. It's quite crazy, but I'm enjoying it.
So when I opened that book, I think I was again very young. So I must have read one line and I used to go to sleep for 5 hours because it was so heavy, you know? So that again, I think is another thing I would like to share. Like when you start this journey, like when I started and now when I look back, like all those things which felt like, oh God, everything is going over the head. And in pranayam class, I would always go to sleep and I, you know, all these things. But today, Kattu, when I look back and when I read these things, everything makes sense. Everything just like, oh, okay. Everything is like when you're in practice, everything is like experiential and it just, it feels amazing. Like I was also very amazed when I went back to the books when I had to, consolidate the course material for the teacher training courses and all. So it was like going back and getting everything together. And it was beautiful because at that time it was intellectual when I had studied it and when I had learned about it. And when I put it all together, it was a completely different experience. And that was really wonderful.
Yeah, I can imagine. Saibat, do you want to ask something? I wanted to go into the student teacher, question on that.
I do have just one quick question. And this was about, you know, when we were talking about whether there is a life's purpose. Do you think that the universe kind of sends you messages, and how does one keep themselves open to tapping into that information? How do I know what the universe is trying to tell me?
Well, if you're open and listening, you get the messages loud and clear all the time.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. I mean, again, that, I feel like I have been guided, you know, like, again, it's about trusting yourself. It's about trusting that intuition, right? That voice inside. And when you start to connect more and you start to trust more, automatically things will come, messages will come, things will happen. And you'll just know, because the more we purify ourselves and the mind, the more connected you get.
So it's more like a cleansing process and then all the dots will connect.
Because imagine you're like a vehicle, right? For the transmission. So if you keep yourself clean, then it's easier to transmit. It's clearer. It's not hazy and muddled.
Okay. All right, Manu, I'll let you get into it.
Okay. So, Shraddha, just coming to, you know, a little bit about who your teachers have been, you know, your mentors, if you can share a little bit about them, who, you know, you feel you've learned from a lot. And also what relationship you like to have with your students. What do you expect from them? What do you like to impart to them? Thoughts on that?
My teachers, I've been blessed actually to have some amazing teachers. All my teachers have been amazing. They've all taught me something or the other. Starting with, one of my teachers in the Shivananda course, Mani sir, I never happened to study with him again, but he was a lovely teacher who kind of ignited the right kind of fire. And after that, I studied in Bombay with a lot of Iyengar, senior Iyengar teachers. And the luckiest part, the most, where I consider myself most blessed, was when I decided to move to Pune. Because again, I was in my 20s and Guruji was alive at that time. And I just thought to myself that, and I really wanted to study and I wanted to deepen my practice. And I don't know what, I was crazy. I just wanted to practice like 10 hours a day. I just wanted to be in the subject. So I was like, what do I do so that I can just be doing this all the time? So one of my teachers said, okay, why don't you try going to Pune? So I got admission and I went to Pune. And that's where I got to, And that's where I got to actually study with Prashantji, Geetaji, Guruji. Like Guruji's granddaughter Abhijata used to conduct the classes, but Guruji used to be there sitting. And just being in that presence, just being in that energy, it was life-changing. I think I just got whatever blessings, you know, every time, every day that I got to just touch Guruji's feet and get his blessings. I think all those blessings, all that energy I really do feel blessed. And I went to Pune. When I decided to move, I decided to move for 1 year. I said, I'll go for 1 year, I'll study and I'll come back. I stayed for 6. So it was like, you know, I had the best of everything and I just kept, like, I was like a sponge. I just kept soaking it in. So, yeah, it's Geetaji, Guruji, Prashantji. And I had the opportunity to teach at a very senior teacher's institute in Pune called Shri Yog. So, she was also Rajeshri Tupe. She was also a great teacher and a mentor who helped me a lot to kind of learn and give me the confidence that I can go forward and do it. And
when you say Abhay Guruji, sir, who do you mean? When you say Guruji, who are you referring to?
BKS Iyengar.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah, I got 2 years with him. So I moved in 2011. So I got...
What was his aura like? Like, what was he? I mean, he's you know, just...
your mouth wouldn't open. You just be like, when Guruji came in. No, it was wonderful. His energy was lovely. It was strong and compassionate at the same time. You know, and to see that discipline, to see that fire, even at that time when he was in his 90s, he would be there in the institute. You know, I would be going for my morning class. I would see him in his house, maybe doing some writing work, and then he would come for self-practice when it was open. From 9 to 12, 3 hours a day, every day he would be in self-practice, he would be doing classes, then he would be in the library. So just to see that, like, Guruji was living it, you know, every moment. So to see that, to see, even to just be in that, was really a blessing, because it doesn't exist anymore, you know?
Yeah. It has to be like your prabhada, right? Is that the correct word for it? Like, you know, like the karma that you've collected.
Prarabdha.
From, like, yeah.
So
to have
that is what.
2 years.
Yes. That is what I do feel, that I must be having a lot of good karma, because the way I've been very lucky to get all these things at such a young age, to be able to get what I've got and to be able to share. I mean, I don't feel like there's no Shraddha when I'm in my class, or when I'm, it's something else that happens, something else that takes over. So I just make sure to keep the vehicle clean, and that's it, to be the transmitter or the catalyst. That's all. And my students' relationship, what I expect from students, from the start only, I have been a very disciplined person when it comes to the subject. I don't know why, maybe that's my personality or whatever it was. There was a certain reverence and respect for the subject. So I never took it lightly. I never took it casually. So I do not expect a casual approach from my students, which means that there has to be a certain level of discipline which is required. And that's it. I mean, I don't push, but I do definitely push people to kind of make those small changes. You know, it's not about, oh, you have to do this handstand, but it's like, okay, you need to come 10 minutes before class. You need to wake up 15 minutes before. Those are the small things which I encourage students to kind of make shift and understand that there is a discipline, there is a certain mind process to the subject, and most certainly make it very clear that it's not an exercise class. It's not some stretching, strengthening class at all. And I think over the years, finally, I'm blessed that now all the students also are like that. You know, all the students are very serious students who are coming because they want to study the subject. because they want to go deeper. No one is coming because, oh, I want to lose weight on my stomach. That's also fine. But luckily, I don't have that anymore. I have people who want to study the sutras who are saying, okay, let's have philosophy sessions over the weekend. Let's discuss. So, yeah. So, I'm very grateful again to be able to have amazing students who I can share with what I would like to share with them.
Yeah, I remember being very scared if I was going to be 5 minutes late for the online class. I was like, oh my God, I don't want to be late. But yeah, I hope someday to attend your philosophy class also.
Anytime. Yeah, the whole, yeah, I think with my philosophy, what is happening naturally, I'm not trying. And it's also because it's the younger generation age group is, I think, the intensive, the youngest. There was a guy, 18-year-old guy, till about 40, 45. So the whole thing is about making this philosophy, like you said, now when you're reading the book, it's too intimidating. There are words, there are it, and then you get lost and you're like, "Arey, forget it. Yeah, it's too much." The whole aim is to make the philosophy really practical, really simple. Remove all these complicated things. The complicated things will come naturally to you once you get into it. But right now, to not make it complicated, to just simplify it. And that's what I think is happening beautifully on these courses, is simplifying it. Because once you get the point of it, then the rest of it doesn't matter because you've got the crux. You know, and that crux is actually really simple. It's not so complicated. It's actually when you get all that complicated and then you realize, oh God, this is what it is. It's that simple. Okay, why did I fry my brains for such a long time?
I'm very keen to attend one of your philosophy sessions myself. I don't know when travel will permit it, but yeah, I might come. In fact, I was just telling Manu the other day that I really want to go for a Vipassana class myself.
You should.
That, building.
Please go. Yeah. It's the best gift you can give yourself, I promise you. It's phenomenal. Trust me. You must go for it.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things that I personally struggle with, and I would imagine a few people do, is you go to the class, you're immersed, you're present, but then you come out of the class and it stays with you maybe for 10 days, but then it's lost. How does that work?
It will get lost. No, it will get lost. And that's why you have to practice every day. And that's when after every day, it becomes a practice every moment.
And Shraddha, just one thing, and I was thinking about this when you were talking, right? We all have certain personality traits, right? Like you said, you're kind of very disciplined about your practice and you want students to be disciplined as well. But how do you draw that balance between how much of a personality you want to be versus the overall human consciousness concept that you're trying to achieve? Like sometimes you find that a conflict between the two.
So I think the key is balance, you know, finding that balance at any point. How do you, 1 second, Hi, so sorry, it just died off. I can't
hear. No problem. You hear me? Yeah, no, we can see you and hear you. Yeah.
Sorry, what were you saying?
No, I was just saying that, look, we all have these inherent personality traits, right? And we're also trying to move forward in our own evolution process.
So when you say personality traits, what do you mean by? Can you be a little more specific?
Like, for example, if I am very obstinate, or if I have, if I'm very, very disciplined, right? And let's say that another person requires me to deal with them in a slightly gentler way instead of using discipline. So how do you balance who you are inherently against who you're trying to be?
Right. Just so again, that So that key, I think, comes with it'll come with practice, because in this process, like exactly what you're saying, there's a fine line where initially you can go on the other side of extremism, and you can become aggressive with that discipline, and go psycho. If oh God, if I don't wake up, I'm gonna be like really pissed off. Then the point is lost. So the thing is that, okay, I'm disciplined, but on a Saturday or a Sunday, if I don't wake up or, whatever, if something goes off, to be completely okay with it. And that has come after a long time. Because I think, again, the way we are built is that we are so strict with ourselves, and we are so harsh on ourselves. And especially the schools like Genesis, Iyengar schools, all very hardcore schools. So you're very strict on yourself. And then after a point, at some point you realize that, okay, this strictness is killing me. So that's when you realize that, okay, there's a line between compassion and strictness, and you have to find that balance for yourself. And I guess when you're, again, you will know when it feels right. You'll just know.
Yeah.
And that's, again, being truthful to yourself, not about what should be, like, oh, I have to drink this one night because that's balance. But if it's not aligning, it's not aligning. If it's aligning, it's aligning. Either ways, you have to just be truthful to yourself about it. Sometimes the problem is you want to have that drink, but then it's like, oh God, I'm not supposed to have that drink. And then there's the conflict, and that's the whole thing where the conflict, and that's more trauma. So we have to reach a stage where if you reach that stage where you have to be okay with, if you want to have a drink, you have a drink. And I feel that the day you reach that stage that you're okay with it, you will not want to have it. Mm-hmm. But you have to get to that stage where you're okay with it, and then naturally you will not want to have it.
Okay.
Shraddha, I'm going to go back to something we were discussing before this, which was about practicing every day and having the practice. Now, I'm assuming, correct me if I'm wrong, that you
Sorry, can you repeat? My thing went off. My battery is down.
No worries. So I was saying that we were talking about having a practice every day and being in constant practice, right, to do the work. I'm assuming you've reached a place where you can do it more on a regular basis. Like, you can do the work on a minute-to-minute basis if you need to. But what is your regular practice? Like, do you meditate every day? Do you, you obviously teach many times in a week, but for your personal self, what is, what are the practices that you follow? What is the routine that you follow?
So what I follow, the normal routine is I normally wake up at around 4:35. I do my meditation. Then I do my own self-practice. Then I get into my class. I finish my classes usually by 11, noon, whatever. And then I have my lunch, I rest. And then evening is usually, most of the time over the years, I've kept my evening for myself. So my evenings are just with the pets, chilling out, doing whatever I need to do. And in the night, maybe read a little bit before I go to sleep, maybe just something. And go to sleep. That's it. By 9:30, 10, I'm in bed. By 6 o'clock, I've had my dinner. So by 9:30, 10, lights out, and it's the same thing that goes on. But I was thinking about it today only, that even though it's a set thing, like someone would think, or I would think of it initially as, I would look at it myself, the old Shraddha would look at it as monotony and boredom. But today I don't look at it like that at all. I look at it as complete contentment and complete, So it's pretty interesting. the own perspective of how I would have looked at things and how I look at things today. It's like someone looks at me, there's nothing now, but that's what it is. You know, it's not so complicated.
You enjoy the simplicity of the routine.
Yeah, it's not so complicated, and that's great. It's great. Like the simple village things, you know, water, this, that, like small things which you, and that's perfect, and that's life.
Yeah. It's a good place to be, for sure.
Yes, you can all come and join in.
I hope so, yeah, soon.
What do you make of I was just going to ask you, what do you make of social media today? And you know, the comparisons that we're constantly living by and everything. There is so much stimulus right outside. And how in, usually it just made, it makes you feel bad about yourself. Like these unreasonable beauty standards.
So for that, you have to be very conscious about what you're feeding in, you know. You have to be conscious about who you're following, what you're watching. So I'm very, very conscious about that. And I don't have any information that's going to fry my brains. You know, I would, like, on a whatever social media, it's what would appeal to me or what I require, what I think, and that's about it. There is no unnecessary, unwanted information. So I don't watch. And that, again, has happened. I've been doing, trying, like, no TV, no newspapers. I get to know what's happening. I know everything that needs to be done, but I don't need to dive into that and depress myself every day of my life. You know, all that media that you're saying, it's so stimulating. There's no requirement. So you, it's a conscious choice how much you choose to stimulate your senses.
It's like you are what you consume, right? I mean, we've been talking about it with
same. What you eat, what you watch, everything.
Right. Shraddha, is there one particular, you know, moment, experience, life struggle that you feel like impacted you? Or do you believe that it could have impacted you, but you managed to control it? And how did you manage? Is my question too, like, broad? Or did it hit a point?
Yeah, it's a bit broad. You can make it a bit narrower.
Okay. What I mean to say is that through your journey, has there been one particular moment or something that happened that you are comfortable with sharing that kind of pushed you in your journey, pushed you further down into your path? Or, you know, so one can realize how, you know, like where you felt like the universe maybe came together to tell you that this has happened to you, so now you need to stop doing this and do that, or something on those lines.
That production was one of those things, because it was so the other side, you know, and that also styling, like, imagine, so external, so like, now I have only 5 clothes and I wear the same clothes, but I was a stylist. So it was, I had to be there to realize, to go to the other side, and I had to be there in production. Making an ad, for example, for Coca-Cola, you know, stressing out and being really nasty. I mean, you know how production is, right? It's a very different vibe most often, and especially whatever I had experienced. So that definitely threw me completely on the other side. But I think once I got into my practice, and something that happened, I mean, everything has happened that's only taken me closer, or rather, I have chosen to make everything that has happened in my life only take me closer to where I need to be. Be it leaving Bombay and going to Pune, or be it getting married and realizing what I had done and why I had done it and what I need to do, and realizing mistakes, realizing how many times we for the wrong reasons, from the wrong spaces. And that actually made me, and that was my biggest fear, you know, and that made me face my biggest fear in life. And when I faced my biggest fear, you realize that the biggest fear is, it's not that bad. because here I am today doing things that I would have probably never done, having my own shala, whatever, yogvid shala, all these things. I wouldn't have been so probably driven towards it and so sure had I not been on the other side, you know? So there's everything, when you see, it's actually everything that's happened has only taken me closer to where and what I want to do and where I need to be.
What was your biggest fear and how did you overcome it?
My biggest fear was getting a divorce. And that's exactly what happened. So my biggest fear since childhood was that I don't want to get a divorce because it's there in the family. And I always thought that, oh, I want to be married and I'll, you know, be a housewife and be happily married after. But when I did that, when I got married, because that's what I thought, it was completely the opposite. And that shattered my existence. You know, when you're, obviously, when you're growing up with something and then that gets shattered, everything gets shattered and then you rebuild from scratch. And when you rebuild, you really understand what is important, what is true, who you are, what you really want. So that gave me a lot of, it made me become more of who I really was rather than who I thought I should be. And today I can very fearlessly say that I am who I am versus, you know, we have these things, right? You're supposed to be like this. You're supposed to do this, X, Y, Z. And I had done that and then everything got shattered. And then this rebuilding has come from a space of like complete freedom. There's no rules and regulations anymore. So I think that's what it's made me do. The subject has made me become more of who I really am than who I think I should be. Even in terms of being a yoga teacher. You know, yoga teacher has to be a certain way, X, Y, Z. I've broken everything. All the barriers have been broken in my mind. And I'm very comfortable with who I am. And I think that's a great thing that I have achieved today.
Yeah. That is an amazing story. Thanks for sharing that.
Thank you so much. It's been lovely to share with you both.
Shraddha, before we let you go, I know we've all overrun our time as well because now it's
that's fine.
Okay, good. So one thing I wanted to ask you was, is there any small, quick technique that we could share with anybody who watches this? Small practice, small technique. I know you shared the breath thing, but anything other that you could share with whoever eventually watches this? Just a quick 2-minute practice, something that can help you reset.
See, you know, that's like a short fix, like a quick fix. Yes. And there are no quick fixes. Mm. So I don't give quick fixes. So you have to do the work. Mm. And if you do the work, then you will not need that quick fix, you know. So Anapana is the honest only suggestion because there's nothing that you can do like that. And if anyone says you can, I don't know. Mm. But I would only stick to Anapana. And because what can you do in 2 minutes? I don't know what I can do in 2 minutes, you know. I can, by the time I put my hands up and I do this and it's gone, like what? Mm-hmm. So I would just say sit, focus on your breath. And again, what I would say is that, you know, today, especially in cities and all, everyone is used to overdoing. Everyone is overdoing their workouts and 2 workouts a day. And I don't know, everyone is like running and doing an excessive amount of things. So my tip would be that please just take a step back. You know, don't overdo so much. Sometimes it's okay to just lie on your back and put your legs up for 2 minutes. That's what I would suggest someone to do. Or rest your head down on a table and quiet in your mind for 2 minutes. Those are things that you actually need to do for 2 minutes versus some technique, which actually, I don't know, it doesn't work, works, whatever. But yes, simple things like that. Put your legs up on the wall, rest your head down on a table. Come back to center. Do whatever it takes in that 2 minutes to come back to center.
That is immensely useful.
Huh?
I said that is immensely useful. That there are no quick fixes is also sufficient.
Yeah, there are no quick fixes.
So in short, for you, what are the biggest benefits of meditation and yoga? Like dhyana, dharana, and asana? Like are they the same? Are they different? How would you explain it simply?
Each one leads to the other. Okay, one step leads to the other. It just flows into the other. Like that's what they say, after mastery of asanas, naturally pranayam will become effortless. Or after pranayam, naturally pratyahara, the withdrawal of senses will happen. You know, it will happen. It's like stage by stage. It's like going from standard class 1, 2, 3. So it's difficult to just straight away go to class 10. So that's why difficult to directly go meditation. Some people come and say, oh, teach us meditation. You can't learn meditation like that. You can't teach it like that. You know, meditation happens. It's not something that you can do. So meditation is actually extended periods of concentration. So, you know, and then again, there's a lot of, sorry, but I'm getting chewed by mosquitoes. It's evening time, but yeah. So there were such big ones.
That's
sitting.
Fine. We can end this. We have chewed your brain enough. Now we can spare you the mosquitoes. Okay, we'll end this. Shraddha, if there is a little message that you would like to give to the Heartwork Collective, anything that you want to share in terms of what we are doing, what we should do, something that maybe we'll put together from, you know, our different members of the collective like you who have shared with us, something for us to use later on in life as a memory. No pressure, anything you want.
Well, I think that you guys are just starting out on your path. So I wish and I pray that you both always be guided and be on the path and just be guided. That's my only sincere request. Because if you're guided, you'll be doing the right things and sharing the right messages.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks, Shraddha. Thank you so much for your time. This was absolutely pleasure talking to you.
It was lovely chatting with both of you too. See you.
See you. Yes,
see you soon.
Bye. Yes. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Shraddha.